My name's Timothy West, and this is my wife, Brunella Scales.
We are a pair of actors of a certain vintage.
Basil?
All the world's a stage, and in our time we both played many parts, but as we head towards the final curtain call, there are still a couple of parts we'd like returning to.
The captain.
Cast off, please.
Aye, sir.
And his mate. Physically, Prue is holding up okay.
I'm stronger than I look.
Although her memory isn't quite what it was.
Oh, my darling, I'm so sorry. I didn't cast you off.
It's true. Some days I don't know whether it's Monday or Lewisham.
Exploring canals and waterways is something we can still do together.
Something we both love.
And together, we've travelled up and down Great Britain and through canals across Europe.
Now it's time to head for waterways anew,
on new continents.
So, we're embarking upon an adventure of a lifetime.
It's the most far-flung and exotic voyage we've ever undertaken. We're heading for India.
It's a bit different, isn't it?
Yeah, like no other canal I've ever seen.
And we're making not just one, but two journeys through this incredible country.
First, we'll explore the tropical backwaters of Kerala in the south.
And our second voyage takes us down a mighty river in Assam, in the far northeast.
Oh, what a wonderful sight.
To make these voyages in our twilight years will no doubt be a challenge.
As we travel the canals and waterways of this extraordinary country,
we'll embrace its vibrant culture.
Oh, thank you.
Taste its history.
This is black gold.
And rediscover forgotten links with home.
So the legendary British cuppa started here.
There are close calls.
It's slightly nerve-wracking, someone coming straight at you.
And downright disasters.
I think its days are probably numbered.
But it promises to be an experience to remember.
It's amazing, mysterious, as if we're heading into an unknown world. Tim and I have been at home enjoying the quiet life for the last few months.
But never far from our minds are plans for the next great escape.
Shropshire Union.
Mm-hmm.
Cauldron Hebble.
Yeah.
Ashby de la Zouge.
Oh, lovely, lovely canal.
Yes, yes.
They're all lovely and they're all individual.
Yeah.
But I was thinking maybe we ought to go a bit further afield this time, do you think?
Les canaux français, peut-être?
Even a bit further than that. What about this?
Ooh, wow.
India.
India?
Mm-hmm.
Exciting. When you say India, you see, I think of the Taj Mahal. I don't think of canals.
Yeah, well, the canals are there in Kerala, down here, southwest tip.
Oh, brilliant. Well, come on, let's go.
Why not? Yeah, let's.
We've been exploring canals for half a century.
But this will be our most ambitious adventure ever. The waterways of India.
For the first voyage, we're heading south to the tropical state of Kerala.
Known as the Malabar Coast, it boasts beautiful palm-lined beaches that hug the ocean for almost 600 miles.
To the east are the fertile Western Ghat Mountains, rich in tea, coffee, and spice plantations.
And sandwiched between the two are the extraordinary Kerala backwaters, a 1,000-mile network of canals, rivers, and lakes.
It's a lush, exotic, and totally unique inland water world.
The backwaters were once a vital link between the spice gardens and Kerala's seaports. We'll be following an ancient spice route through this labyrinth of canals. Near the old fishing village of Kumarakom, we're picking up our vessel for the onward voyage.
Right, and there she is.
Oh,
it's a traditional boat called a ketawalam.
Yes.
Looks as if it's made of raffia, but it isn't. It's wood woven together and tied with strips of coir.
Fantastic.
Perfectly safe.
Perfectly safe, you say?
Yes, I reckon. Yes, yes, yes.
Right. Can I get a hand?
Yeah.
To navigate the backwaters, this rather grand vessel was our only viable option. and she comes with a couple of crew.
A slice of canal luxury to which I could easily become accustomed.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
What do you think?
Is it alcoholic?
Not sure. Quite unusual anyway, isn't it?
Yeah. Right.
These boats were originally simple covered cargo vessels. Today's versions are called houseboats, available to rent. And they come with rather sumptuous cabin quarters.
Oh!
Wow. Look.
It's a bit bridal, isn't it?
Go in.
Thank you.
Look. Oh. Oh. Very romantic, isn't it?
Yeah. Don't get welcome like this on the Leeds Liverpool, do you?
No, you certainly don't. But I'm sorry, darling, we can't linger long. It's all hands on deck.
Right, you are, skipper. Casting off.
It's quite an operation moving this boat, isn't it?
Before I take the helm, I thought it a good idea to ask the crew to get me started and show me how to navigate these shallowest of waters.
What a sight. It's a bit different, isn't it?
Yeah, like no other canal I've ever seen.
We've both been to India before. I've even worked here. But these canals are something quite new. Thrilling.
For the next 7 days, we'll be following the ancient spice route, navigating the same channels that spice traders have taken for centuries.
Crossing India's second largest freshwater lake, we'll weave our way through the intricate network of canals and rivers to a town known as the Venice of the East.
Visiting a temple dedicated to the god Krishna, we'll end our journey at Old Quilon, a spice port that Marco Polo visited 700 years ago.
I suppose some people might think we're pushing our luck a bit, navigating a strange canal in a rather unusual boat in India.
We've been to India before and we're supposed to know about canals.
Yeah.
I think we'll be all right.
Gliding through this seeming paradise of tropical canals, one could easily get the sense that life on the backwaters is laid back. But you'd be mistaken. Everywhere we look, locals are going about their daily business beside or on the water.
You forget about the road here, don't you? If there is a road, everything is geared to the canal.
Yes.
They live on the canal.
Yes.
We've been joined by local guide Lijo Isaac, who was brought up beside these canals.
Lijo, you know the backwaters very well.
Yes.
What's your link with them? Is it family?
Yes. So my great-grandfather used to be a farmer in one of these paddy fields that you see on the sides of backwaters. Yes. And then they used to take crops, coconut husks, spices to city centers like Kottayam and Alappi. And whenever the boat used to come back, after selling all the things, it used to be a mini festival in the little village.
Of course, the canals also have a use in the irrigation of the land, don't they?
Yes.
I mean, it reminds me very much of Holland, where some of the farming is below sea level.
Correct. Yeah, so backwaters in Kerala is one of the few places in the world where the farming happens below the sea level.
Kerala's paddy fields sit up to 3 meters below sea level, in soil made fertile by rich sediments from the hills and the sea. A series of bunds, or dikes, keep the salt water away from the crops, whilst the canals help to irrigate the fields.
Unlike most canals back home, the backwaters are still carrying spices and other goods right into the 21st century, but I suspect times are beginning to change.
So are they mainly used for leisure now, or are some of them still useful for commercial transport?
Yes, it is still used for commercial. There are a lot of waterways in Kerala where you can't possibly reach by road. So this is one of the few places in the world where the life is still like the old days, where you are still using boats to ply.
It's a canal economy.
Yeah, it's a canal economy completely, whether it is tourism or whether it is cargo or transport. And like the people in cities use buses, people here use ferry boats to go to school every day. And in the morning, if you come in this area, you can also see some of the children going on the boats on their own. The children who are, the children who are around the ages of 7 and 8.
Yes.
They make boards from coconut trees and other big trees.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting way of going to school. I myself never had the luck of doing that. I hope you had when you were rich.
No, not at all.
Yeah, maybe the children are not realizing how lucky they are to have something like this.
Yeah, it's a wonderful waterway.
Canal heaven.
There's no escaping it. The time has come for me to master this unfamiliar vessel. As a regular canal boat skipper, the steering position seems to me to be at quite the wrong end.
But Josh, tell me, how is it to steer? Is it hard because you're a long way away from the rudder, aren't you? Is it hard work?
Yeah, very hard work. Very hard in rudder. Here, two side is very high, that deep, not deep.
Not deep,
the only deep, the center side.
Right, yes.
So, now it's my turn. I just hope I don't make a total hash of it.
What's it like steering from the bow?
Well, you can see that it takes a little while for anything to respond to it.
Yeah. The ducks are applauding you, darling, or are they laughing?
Not sure. Well, you try.
This is going to take some getting used to.
We've a long voyage ahead, darling, so let's hope you master it soon.
We're in India, on a voyage of a lifetime, following the spice route through the canals of Kerala's backwaters.
We may be old canal hands, but this is a voyage like no other. Lush, tropical channels of green, palms seeming to bend to greet us as we drift by, the air hot, humid, and brooding.
As I always say, you're not in the countryside, you're under it.
Yeah. Yes, whether it's oaks and willows or bamboos and mango trees.
Well into the 20th century, the backwaters were the roads of Kerala, transporting goods from the interior to the ports. And the most valuable cargo was spice.
Like generations of spice traders before us, today we've traveled to the ancient city of Kochi on the edge of the Arabian Sea.
For centuries, this port was the heart of Kerala's rich spice trade. Merchants from east and west were drawn here to trade in ginger, cardamom, and black pepper. Walking the streets, it's clear that they left their mark on the city.
Brunton's Boatyard, I hope. Home from home.
Yes, absolutely.
Once, the ships of the spice trade were built and maintained on this site. Today, it's a rather swish hotel.
Well, certainly very colonial, isn't it?
Yes.
Canal?
Oh, yes.
The Raj was consigned to history 70 years ago. I'm in no way nostalgic for the empire, but I do have family connections to India, going back for generations.
Here we are, tea.
Oh, good, lovely. Thank you. Right.
Of course, I remember when we were kids, Britain still had an empire, and we were still ruling India.
My father fought here.
Yeah.
In the 1920s in the Northwest Frontier.
And of course, your family still had business interests over here, didn't they? Scales, wool, and stuff. So the country was probably still full of all your relatives. They get everywhere, don't they?
In the 19th century, Grandpa Scales had a cotton office in Bombay. And between 1918 and 1920, my dad was a major, seconded to the Indian Army, serving on the Northwest Frontier.
I can't help wondering what it must have been like to live out here back then. My father adored it. I mean, he always wanted to come back.
Well, let's go and explore a bit.
Right.
Get a sense of what it might have been like. Okay.
The British may have been the last colonists on these shores, but they certainly weren't the first. 2,000 years of the spice trade has created a diverse ethnic mix not found in the rest of India.
What an extraordinary way of fishing.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? They're called the Chinese fishing nets. It's an idea brought to the Malabar coast. Some say from China, some say from Portugal, about 600 years ago. But it's quite effective.
Yes,
you see how it works? Where the guy walks along this teak gangway, yes, and the whole thing is pulled in by hand. Quite an ingenious winding mechanism. And they bring up the nets and they see what they've got. Enormous interest to the gulls and egrets.
Yes.
Everything they pull up, they actually sell it immediately in those little stalls there. So it passes by the fish absolutely fresh. Well, look, here we go. It's coming up. Let's see what they've got. Bravo!
Once the Chinese have left Kochi with their way of fishing, the British left behind a network of canals. We take a water taxi to explore.
There you can see signs of the old boatyard.
Yes.
An old boatyard, certainly. I mean, all this really is some evidence of the old port. Looking a bit sad now.
Yes.
Yeah, British canal, sir.
Here? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Aha.
Uh-huh.
Thank you. Right.
Although Kerala was never strictly part of the Raj, the British still controlled much of its spice trade. Using their canal building experience, between 1840 and 1880, they constructed dozens of canals in Kochi. Back then, the waterways were teeming with spice boats, bringing their precious cargo from the backwaters to the port.
It's like our coal canals, isn't it? It's a working canal.
Well, it was. It didn't carry coal, it carried pepper and spices down
from
the hills.
Yes, right.
But that's in the past, I'm afraid. Hello.
Hi.
The canals may not be the transport highways they once were, but the spice trade is still the lifeblood of Kerala. At the heart of Kochi lies the historic spice market. And we're making our way to an 18th century ginger warehouse to meet a former mayor of the city.
Mr. Sohan.
Hello, how are you?
Hello.
Namaste.
Thank you for welcoming us.
How do you do?
Tell us about these amazing buildings.
This is a typical warehouse. These spices that you see everywhere is produced on the hills. And it is brought here through the backwaters. You can see this?
Yes.
Center courtyard. This is where the ginger is processed.
The ginger is laid out to dry in the sun.
I've never seen it looking like this.
This area has been, because of the spices, I suppose, an extraordinary mixture of different people, all apparently getting on well together.
Yeah, yeah. It is a mosaic. I always say everybody came for the spices. They didn't come for the love of us or the hate of us.
No.
Just trade.
For centuries, Europeans have been entranced by the spices of India. And out of all the exotic Eastern flavors, the one they craved the most was black pepper.
Of course, pepper was the most valuable commodity, wasn't it?
Yeah. Pepper was the main driving force of the whole spice trade.
Yes.
And in Europe, it was so costly, it was called black gold.
So, this is black gold.
That's black gold.
Merchant of Venice.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Shakespeare comes back with this word.
Well, it's very hot.
Yeah.
In the time of the Bard, it was so rare and so valuable that peppercorns were used as a form of international currency.
It's the spices that created the first globalization.
Yes.
And the first cosmopolitanization. All these ethnic communities from all over the world living together, trading. The only language was money and spices.
Yes.
Languages are so different.
Unity through
and
spice.
This is the first thing that brought the whole world to our place.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
so
you,
much.
All of you.
The heady aromas of ginger linger in the air, reminding us that for millennia, the world came to Kerala in search of spice, a commodity that was once incredibly exotic and infinitely desirable.
Leaving the city behind, we continue our voyage south, heading for the old port of Quilon. Now the canals of the backwaters open up, as we come to the vast Lake Venbanad.
It's very big, isn't it? Very big lake. In fact, it's the second largest freshwater lake in India, currently.
Massive.
The lake is 60 miles from end to end. Over 1.5 million people live on its banks and are dependent on it for their livelihoods.
What exactly are they doing, Tim?
They're fishing by hand.
Where are the hooks or bait?
No, they don't use hooks or anything. See what they're doing?
Yes.
One man is scaring the fish. They live in very, very shallow water.
Yes.
And the frightened fish go and hide in the mud. So these men dive down, catch the fish, and shove them in the boat.
These fishermen dive to depths of up to 25 feet with no breathing equipment, no net, no hooks. It's got to be the oldest and most rudimentary form of fishing there is. And it's been practiced in Kerala for tens of thousands of years.
It's quite a basic way of fishing, isn't it? A boat and a naked person and jump in and... Do they catch them with their hands?
Catch them with their hands, yes. And they put the hands in the mud.
Yes.
And pull them out. Have a fish? Yes.
Oh, brilliant. Oh, yeah.
Quite a big one.
Well, hooray, well done them.
As we near the end of the day, sitting atop our houseboat and watching the villages float by is all the evening entertainment one could wish for.
Everybody coming home and going to bed.
Yes.
All the way along the waterway. Silence falling. Extraordinary. How are you enjoying it so far?
I'm fascinated, yes, I'm intrigued. I mean, canals with bamboo and palm trees. It's so different from our own experience of English canals, isn't it?
It's a world away from the canals back home. But sharing these peaceful moments together is as wonderful as always.
This is part of a long poem called The Gardener by Rabindranath Tagore.
Yes.
Where do you hurry with your basket this late evening when the marketing is over? They all have come home with their burdens. The moon peeps out from above the village trees. The echoes of the voices calling for the ferry run across the dark water to the distant swamp where wild ducks sleep. Where do you hurry with your basket when the marketing is over? Sleep has laid her fingers upon the eyes of the earth. The nests of the crows have become silent, and the murmurs of the bamboo leaves are silent. The labourers, home from their fields, spread their mats in the courtyards. Where do you hurry with your basket when the marketing is over?
Thank you for bringing me to India.
Cheers. Cheers.
We're on a voyage in southern India, following the spice route through the tropical backwaters of Kerala, bound for the historic port of Quilon. But this morning, we've awoken to some commotion.
So, Shoes, what's gone wrong?
Yes. Rudder problem, sir.
So, you've taken the pin out?
Yes.
Yes.
Rudder broken.
It's broken, yeah.
It's not good news. It appears that the rudder has sheared off.
Yes, obviously what's happened is you run against the pier, trying to turn too sharply, and it's just broken off.
I wasn't at the helm at the time, I'm happy to say.
It's a lovely houseboat, but it's not the newest vessel in Kerala. And it looks like the bump has caused another small issue.
Yes, the prow's dropped into the water. It's been around a long time, and I'm sure it's done sterling service, but I think its days are properly numbered.
Without a rudder, this boat is grounded. Whilst the crew take off to see if it can be fixed, our journey comes to a halt. Well, darling, what do sailors do when they're forced to stay in port? They head for the local hostelry.
Along here is the toddy shop.
Toddy? Oh, right. Where are we going?
In here, I think.
Good.
Across Kerala, the government is restricting the sale of alcohol as they move toward a total ban in the years to come.
Good afternoon.
Toddy, yes, please.
Mercifully, there is one hallowed exception, the local drink of toddy.
Delicious.
It's good. Nothing to do with hot toddy, which we think of.
No, right.
You know, which is whiskey and lemon.
What's it made of?
The sap of the palm tree.
Oh.
They scrape it off the leaves and leave it to ferment and it turns into this.
And it's highly alcoholic, is it?
Highly alcoholic, but it's alcoholic enough. You'd be all right. Wonder when they're going to fix this boat. Does it matter?
Who cares?
After our liquid lunch, we return to the boat to discover there's some good news.
Well, looks like our rudder's arrived at last, and then, of course, they've got to fit it, which may take a little while. Then we can resume our journey.
This voyage through the Carolan backwaters could be seen as quite a challenge for two octogenarians. But the irony is that so far it's not our age that's been the issue, but the age of our boat.
Yes, well, the whole thing's sheared off, and you can see it's been forged and welded, so looks okay. Just don't do it again. We've been through this a bit on the canals, rudder shearing. I'd love to give you my hand, of course, but I think my underwater engineering days, such as they were, thing of the past.
The rudder repair is in capable hands.
Yes, very good.
But I'm not sure what's going on with the prow.
They're knitting us on.
Yeah.
Doesn't look very secure, does it?
No.
Our old boat has been patched up, but I suspect it's only a matter of time before something else goes wrong.
I know the feeling.
Today, we're bound for the main channel leading into Alipi. Exploring the town's canal network, we'll then continue our voyage southeast, mooring up at Kanchipadam.
We're approaching the outskirts of Alipi. Once, its canals were full of vessels with cargoes of coconuts, spices and coir. Today, the town is known as the houseboat capital of Kerala, and these boats are all carrying tourists.
Sometimes you feel that you're on a battlefield and there's an enemy force coming towards you.
Yes.
Very quietly and inscrutably. Because they don't look friendly, do they?
No, that one's frowning.
They haven't got friendly faces. Blimey, it's like Charing Cross Road, isn't it?
There's
another one behind.
Unbelievable. They're so busy.
I'll just go between them, shall I? Yes.
Well, that was a little close for comfort.
It's slightly nerve-wracking sometimes with someone coming straight at you.
Like driving on Indian roads, navigating Kerala's canals takes quick reactions and a steady nerve. But so far, we've made it through unscathed.
We're neither of us as young as we used to be, but why not come to India? All right, we're not youthful backpackers, but we're enjoying ourselves, taking it a bit easy, a bit more quietly than we used to be. Prue particularly mustn't really be involved in very hard work, but she'll still enjoy what she's doing. So will I.
Our canal adventures are something we can both share. Now more than ever, it's important to keep looking forward and enjoy all that life has to offer together.
Time to disembark and explore Alleppey. Lord Curzon, the Viceroy of India, dubbed it the Venice of the East, and the town has a rich canal heritage that's both British and Indian.
Oh, this looks more like the canals we're used to.
Yeah, it's like a sort of run-down little Venice, isn't it? It is, in fact, a British canal.
Is it?
Yeah. And together with a parallel canal that was built earlier by the Indians,
yes,
it combined to make Alleppey a really important trading port, second only to Bombay.
Hooray! Yeah. God bless the canals.
Built to link the backwaters to the sea, these canals were the vision of the entrepreneurial Maharaja of Travancore, who in the 18th century established a port and a city-wide network of canals, much of which, sadly, has fallen into disrepair.
Tim,
that's right.
Hi, Prue, nice to meet you. So welcome to the Alleppey Canals.
Thank you.
We're going to take a small boat ride.
Okay.
Right.
To explore the town's surviving canals, we're taking a more familiar vessel with our guide, Manisha Panika, whose links to these waterways go back generations.
So the Alleppey Canals have a huge significance to our family because my grandfather traded in coir. So he had a farm and they used to collect coconut. He had about 200 loomsmen that worked in his factory. And every day they'd load up small boats and then come to the Alleppey Canals and trade with Western tradesmen. Traditionally in Kerala, years ago, we didn't have roadways. So the Travancore Maharaja and the Kochi Maharaja, they developed the waterways. And these were sort of man-made. So there were these channels of water and the Travancore Maharaja created the banks around it.
Right.
With his network of trade canals, the Maharaja's port boomed and for many years rivaled the port of Kochi, which at that time was run by the Dutch. But a century later, as ships grew too large for Alleppey's shallow port, the city's fortunes waned.
So, Prue, do you see that over there?
Yes.
So they're loading on spices onto the truck. Now they load onto trucks, but they used to load onto larger boats.
I feel sad about that. I mean, they used to load onto canal boats, and now they load onto trucks.
Yeah.
I love canals. I think we should use them much more than we do, you know, for everything.
Yeah. So that's what's happening now. The Indian government is working with other governments to develop the waterways.
Hooray.
And so the water taxis, and soon we'll be like shipping things out by boats
great.
Again.
Well, that's lovely.
Yeah.
The streets of India are thrilling and vibrant, packed with life, but it can get a bit much for me. So it's rather nice to be able to retreat to the relative calm and tranquility of our boat.
Increasingly, Prue finds comfort in familiar environments. And after 50 years on the canals, a boat quickly becomes a home from home. So this evening, rather than trekking off somewhere new, I've arranged for some rather special guests to come to us.
I've got a little treat for you.
Oh, what?
Well, you've always been fascinated with movement and dance, haven't you?
Well, yes.
Bet you've never done a Kerala dance.
No, never. Ha ha.
You see.
Oh, brilliant.
Kerala is famous for its traditional dances.
Hello.
Hello.
So I've invited performer and instructor Veena Latish to teach Prue one of its most revered.
This is the costume for Mohiniyattam.
For Mohiniyattam?
The art form of Kerala, yeah.
Yes, I see.
Yeah, yeah. Which means the beautiful enchantress covered in golden ornaments.
I've loved dance ever since drama school. I'm not sure I can still pull off a beautiful enchantress, but I'll give it a go.
Whereas we are doing the blessings of God, to get the blessings of God first in Mohiniyattam. Okay?
Yes.
In the first steps, they.
Good, I've understood.
Right.
Yeah.
You should swirl your movements like this.
The dance is all about graceful gliding movements. Not that you'd guess that from looking at me.
Oh, come on, you're doing brilliantly.
From left side to right, and cross your leg to the left side. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. Looks fine. How do you feel?
Not beautiful enough to do it.
Oh, come on.
If I'm to become an enchantress like these gorgeous girls, I'm going to need all the help I can get.
Do you want me to look just like that?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
My husband would like me to look exactly like that.
Yeah.
Rooted in Hindu mythology, Mohiniyattam is considered a religious art form, but it's had a checkered history.
Actually, this dance form was performed in the temples from very ancient times.
Yes.
And it was done as an offering to the gods and deities.
Yes.
After that, this art form was brought to the royal courts of the kings. The dignity of this art form come to the lower position.
Yes.
And these dancers were treated as the prostitutes.
During the days of the Raj, the sensual Mohiniyattam was performed by dancers known as Devadasi. Dancers were seen by some as rather too racy and were eventually banned. Today, the Mohiniyattam has been revived as a traditional Keralan dance.
When we put this makeup, the fingers will look larger.
I feel like Lady Macbeth.
I've watched Prue perform on many stages, but this is a first, a houseboat on the Kerala backwaters.
Well, I may have to wait a little while for my enchantress. Won't be the first time.
Having donned the traditional costume of white and gold, with jasmine in my hair and adorned with fine jewellery, I'm starting to feel more the part. Perhaps I'm finally ready to entrance.
In the 54 years of our marriage, I've never seen Prue looking quite so exotic.
The dance takes between 10 and 15 years to master. Let's hope I can pull off at least a few steps. The enchantress of this dance is in fact the god Vishnu, who takes a female form to captivate the demons and help good prevail over evil. So I suppose that makes Tim the demon.
Brilliant, thank you.
Well done. Thank you for having me, as they say. It's a great honour.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Come. Welcome, welcome.
I was very proud to be with you. Thank you very much for including me.
We are all looking enchanting, including Prue.
Well, after 53 years of marriage, I've got to find some way to keep him interested, you know.
Keep it on.
Well, you're not doing so badly so far.
As dawn breaks in Kerala, the backwaters slowly come to life.
This is a lovely little thing now. Idyllic.
I know, gorgeous.
I'm so glad I could share it with you.
We've been sharing canal adventures for 50 years so far, and long may it continue.
We're on the final leg of our voyage, following the spice route to the ancient port of Quilon.
Today, we're bound for the spiritual heart of the Kerala backwaters, the temple at Ambalapura. From there, we'll travel further south before heading to the coast and our final destination.
So where to now, Skipper?
We're going to a temple.
Oh, good, right.
A long, long time ago, the Raja of Alabupura was boating in these waters.
Yes.
When he heard the distant sound of a beautiful flute and couldn't think where it was coming from, but there was a tree growing out of the water, and sitting in the tree was Krishna playing the flute. So the Maharaja drained the whole bit of water around the tree, and it became a site on which he built this temple that we're going to now.
Oh, right.
We've stopped off at the odd canalside church or even cathedral before, but this will be our first Hindu temple.
And we hope we'll be in time for its famous ritual, which is performed every day at noon.
It's just a short walk, but it's a touch more hazardous than we expected.
Oh, hello. Good morning. Good morning. And the horns.
Oh. I think the correct expression is holy cow.
All right. Yeah.
So I guess I'm fine.
We reach the temple confines, where ceremonies are already in progress. And we're greeted by the temple guardian, Sri Kumar.
This temple, it is dedicated to Lord Sri Krishna, and it was very famous in India and also in Kerala.
Yes.
Very famous.
Touring the temple with Sri Kumar, it's clear that Lord Krishna has many female followers.
There are a lot of women here.
Yes. In Hindu mythology, Krishna is very popular among women.
Yes.
He is always along with a female. In it is history, it says that he has got 1,008 wives.
Oh, right.
Single
That's
Krishna
good.
Has got 1,008
wives.
So, he leaves love yes. to everybody.
Love to everybody.
Everybody.
Yes.
Well, so, after your offering also, God is satisfied with your love to God.
Yeah. Right.
Well, for us, God is love.
Also.
Krishna is popular with young families too, who bring their babies here for the naming ceremony, Namkaran.
Hello. Hello. A beautiful baby. You're a beautiful baby. I got a smile. I got a laugh.
Yeah.
Although we're not Hindus, we're invited to make an offering to Krishna.
So what happens here?
You are offering your equal quantity of banana to gods. That is the offering.
It seems one of us has to be weighed, not in pounds and ounces, but in bananas. And then we pay the temple for the cost of the fruit.
Well, it had better be me then. We don't want to take out a second mortgage at our age.
Oh, charming. Here we go then. Prunella, scales, and some bananas.
Very good. Not that many bananas.
You would have got a better deal if you'd used my husband.
Yes, okay.
We've made our offering and are still in time for the famous daily ritual of Paizan. As part of a legendary pact with Lord Krishna, huge vats of sweetened rice are made by the temple's devotees and served to pilgrims and curious visitors like us.
Sort of like sweet rice pudding, isn't it? There's a story that Krishna, when he was on his travels, came to a local Raja and challenged him to a game of chess.
Yes.
And Krishna said, if I win, you've got to pay me in rice. And we will put pieces of rice on the chessboard. One piece of rice on the first square, two grains on the second square, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64.
And so it went on, doubling up 64 times. Lord Krishna won the game, and the Raja discovered he owed rather a lot of grains of rice. Actually, around 13 trillion. The temple is still paying off his debt today, in the form of the Paisam rice dish.
Well, Dad will teach the Raja to take on a god at chess.
Absolutely.
Our journey certainly seems to have been blessed by the gods. We've enjoyed spectacular canals.
Survived with the boat just about intact.
And now we've made it to our final destination, the ancient spice port of Quilon, a name derived from the Sanskrit word for pepper.
The Roman writer Pliny, the Venetian merchant Marco Polo, and the Portuguese explorer Vasco da Gama all visited what was for centuries one of the most important ports in India.
It's really nothing but a fishing centre now, but at one time, this was the site of one of the oldest ports in Kerala. Yeah. People used to come from all over the world here to do their trading.
Imagine the whole bay full of square riggers.
Yeah. Portuguese, yes. Dutch, British. Yeah. They're all gone now, of course. And all that's left is this fort.
Echo of a lost empire. Mm.
Our voyage through Kerala has truly been one of discovery. Colonial powers may have come and gone, but the Keralan people seem to have held on to their tolerant, warm, and welcoming spirit.
So, for thousands of years, this place has been a sort of melting pot where people came from all over the world to trade goods and exchange ideas.
Yeah, that's right. So,
amazing.
Perhaps that old imperialist Rudyard Kipling got it right. Oh, east is east, and west is west, and never the twain shall meet, till earth and sky stand presently by a great God's judgment seat. But there is neither east nor west, nor border, breed, nor birth. When two strong men stand face to face, though they come from the ends of the earth.
Well, it certainly feels like we've come a long way.
Well, we've made it here together.
Darling, there's nowhere I'd rather be.
Next time, we venture deeper into India and brave the vast Brahmaputra River.
No canal hazards at all.
Just strong currents and hidden sandbars.
Leaving the canals behind to explore the unique culture of this region.
Wow!
What are we going to moor to?
I don't know.
What are we going to tie up to? Bloody hell.
Still to come tonight on Channel 4 at 10:15, a charismatic serial killer is playing mind games with his pursuers in the Brazilian crime thriller Merciless. Before that, how good is your Latin? Messages from the past in The Handmaid's Tale. Next.